Good evening. My name is Judith Thurman, and I'm welcoming you to this really adventurous notion of a literary festival program. This is, of course, the Penn World Voices Festival, and this is Babette's Feast 2.0. The theme of the evening is roots and routes, or roots and routes, depending on how you want to pronounce the theme. I'm the biographer of Isak Dinesen, or Karen Blixen, as she's known in Scandinavia, who wrote Babette's Feast. And in a way, I think that she is my co-host tonight. Many of you may have read her work, and some of you may have seen the wonderful film made of Babette's Feast, her tale, by Gabriel Axel, who died this year at 95 in February. The story is an unusual one in her oeuvre. It was the product of a bet. She was old. She was living back in Denmark after her many years in Africa. She was always short of cash, unlike the rest of us. And a friend bet her that she couldn't write something for the lucrative American market. And so she took the bet, and the friend who's English and a snob said, well, the magazine market we're talking about. She said, well, you should write about food. The Americans like food. So Babette's Feast, which is an extraordinary story, a perfect story in many ways, was the product of this bet. And it's a sublimely literary, mystical, very cultivated work. And she sent it first to the Ladies Home Journal and then the Saturday Evening Post. And they all said, oh, well, no, it's a bit too, you know, for the upper income brackets for us. We couldn't possibly publish it. Eventually, it was published, and it was collected in Anecdotes of Destiny years later. But I just wanted to talk for a minute about Babette's Feast, and then we'll talk to the chef of our own Babette's Feast. I'm not mystical myself, but this morning I was looking out my window. I live on the top floor. My bedroom's on the top floor of an old house, overlooks gardens, and there's a big old 300-year-old elm tree. And in the branches of this elm tree, which were very spare and just beginning to come into bud, in the pale green, there was a red cardinal sitting on the branch. And Dinesen, she has written several stories with major characters, Cardinal Salviati, and he's one of her alter egos, and he represents the sacrifice, the priestly sacrifice of life for art. And Babette is another of her alter egos. And Babette is the consummate artist who also, in the course of this tale, makes the sacrifice of everything that she has for a moment of pure and perfect artistic expression. And I reread the story this morning, and I found myself weeping. And I haven't read it in a long time. And I said, why are you crying? What are these tears for? And I realized that they were on several scores. One, I hadn't listened to Dinesen's voice in a long time. And Dinesen, the voice of the artist as opposed to the voice of the woman, is someone who's transcended her sorrows, who's transcended her losses, and has turned them into tales. And that's also what Babette's Feast is about. And at a certain point in life, that notion of transcendence is very consoling. And I think one of the great things about Dinesen is just that, her power to console. So I welcome you to this lovely evening. We have wonderful writers who are going to read to us and talk to us. And then we're going to, in the spirit of the feast, we're going to talk to each other. If you feel like it, I don't want to be sort of a dominatrix about this, despite my weird rubber dress. You may want to change places and move away from the friend that you came with and just talk to a stranger. That would be very Babettian. There'll be time for that if you want to do that. So the original Babette's Feast was a meal made by Babette, the French cook who arrives in a poor and austere Norwegian village and is taken in by two sisters who are the daughters of a famous Puritan dean, a churchman. And the actual feast consists of extraordinarily recherché and expensive and French dishes, including famously caille en sarcophage, which is a dish of quails with truffles and baked in pastry. Turtle soup made from a live turtle. And we're not having caille sarcophage, not having turtle soup or anything endangered. So now that we've established that, I'd like our chef to tell us a bit what we are having, Rasmus.
Of course. Welcome everybody. I am the chef at the Copenhagen Danish restaurant located in Tribeca. I'm so thrilled about making this feast for you guys. It's definitely going to be nothing like the French cuisine that you guys have read about. We're going to Denmark instead, obviously. What you guys have in front of you is what we serve for lunch.
Yeah.
can I do it without? Is that right?
Was it okay before?
Yeah, it's fine.
No, don't.
No.
Can I say that?
All right. What you guys got in front of you is what we serve for lunch at the restaurant. It's our farm food. It's smørrebrød, not to compare with smørgåsborg or smørgåschef or whatever chain is uprising in New York. We do the legit stuff. It's served on rye bread. You guys are having three different types. You're having our take on a classic Danish liver pate. It's served with bacon, pickled cucumbers. You're having a gravel salmon, which is kind of like cured, just mixed with a lot of dried spices. So it has this not spicy, but spiced flavor, served with a classic Danish sauce called rævesauce. In English, that's directly translated into fox's sauce, but it's a brown sugar and mustard sauce. And you also have a vegetarian option, which is a kale tartare. It's a kale salad with walnuts, pears, and pickled sunchokes. In the bread baskets, and there's a cutting board out there as well, there's two types of bread. One of them is a classic sourdough bread, and the brown one is a malt bread. Malt is something we utilize a lot in Denmark. We usually know it from beer. We like to utilize it in everything we can do, basically. It's toasted barley. In my opinion, it has an extremely beautiful burnt note, very deep, and enhances the bread type we use for it as well. You have small balls of home whipped butter with buttermilk and an in-house made smoked cheese. So the smørrebrød is a very classic take on Danish food culture, and the bread, the butter, is more like what we do at dinner, very Nordic, very clean, trying to incorporate things from our food culture into 2014. I hope you guys are not going to miss any turtles, or, I mean, truffles everybody miss, but apart from that, I hope you guys enjoy.
Thank you. At some point, we'll need you to also just pass the bread, because I think it's spaced around the table, so just one more word about the Danish feasts. You know, there's a tradition in Danish filmmaking, in Danish literature, of the family party, and some of you saw Festen, the celebration, which is a very dark film. It was the first dogma film. By Thomas Vinterberg, and there's which is a family gathering celebrating an anniversary at which all of the dirty secrets come out, and Lynn Ullmann, who's part of the Penn Festival, will be speaking on Saturday. There's a fest, and there's a guest about in her book too, also rather sinister. At the end of Fanny and Alexander, the great Bergman movie, there's a christening party haunted by a ghost. But the spirit of Babette's feast is one of reconciliation and transcendence. There's no ghosts at the end. It's just haunted by the notion of the reunion of the spiritual and the sensual. So enjoy your meal. Now, normally at a Danish meal, the person at the left of the hostess now makes the scone.
That's good.
So this is the Danish consul? Yes? Would you like to do this
golf? Yeah. Yeah, we don't have the songs as the Swedes do. We're very quick, so we just say skål, and then we drink. The rest and the hair. Yeah, skål.
So you can start eating, and then we'll do the readings will come one after another as we eat.
Medications.
to say hi. It's nice. It feels
Nobody has to stop chewing for the moment. We're going to do our readings and our conversations at intervals throughout the meal. So our first reader is Christian Jungersen. He's a Danish novelist, very handsome, I have to say. And tall. Yes, you all are. It's very peculiar about that. His work has been translated into more than 20 languages and has received or been nominated for prizes all over the place: the United Kingdom, France, Sweden, Ireland, and Denmark, his native Denmark. His latest novel, You Disappear, was just published here by the Nantes Doubleday, a very distinguished publisher. And in the Start Kirkus Review, it described the book as an intelligent, at times even intellectual, novel about philosophical issues of identity and moral responsibility, which is very apt for Dinesen's Babette. Jungersen writes brilliantly and raises knotty questions of identity. He will be reading from You Disappear, and we can talk to him about it when he's finished with the reading, and then he can have another bite of his sandwich.
Thank you. Very happy to be here. I need to figure out the microphone situation. Thank you.
That'll be a little easier.
I'm going to read a few pages from this, my latest novel in English, You Disappear. I'm going to read from the very beginning of the book. We whoosh down between dark rock faces, through hairpin turns, down and round, past dry scrub, silver pale trees, and back up. Then over a ridge where the car nearly leaves ground, and Nicholas and I whoop as our entrails become weightless. The hot Mediterranean air buffets our faces, for all four windows are open. Frederick takes a curve so fast that I grab my headrest. The sea beneath us keeps switching left and right. Normally, Frederick's never brave behind the wheel, so I try not to be too afraid. And the heat makes the rocks steeper, darker, the lemon groves prickling even more tartly in my nose, the sea shining blue like I've never seen it before. Around, yet another rock outcrop, and suddenly we're engulfed by cyclists. I scream, a swarm of neon pink cycling jerseys. I look out the back window. No one's fallen, but they've dismounted from their bikes, clenched fists, open mouths. We round the next curve. Frederick, it's not funny anymore. He doesn't answer. Frederick. He lets out a small sigh and maintains his speed. I observe his long, slender fingers wrapped around the wheel. They don't belong to this way of driving. Once I found them erotic, like miniature versions of his body, tall and thin, a swaying, relaxed body, not a speed demon's. And is it the speed that makes his eyes look deeper? Black, violet, massive, he seems strange, though I can't say where the difference lies. Another hard bump, and again all three of us rise into the air. Stop, Frederick, stop, I yell. Nicholas has had his head out the window, now he pulls it back in. Mom, just leave off. I'm supposed to leave off. Your father's driving like a complete madman. He'll kill us. Is that what you want? It's the speed, the colors, the heat, and all the outrageous Mallorcan beauty. Nicholas sighs with precisely the same sibilance as his father and leans again, his head out the window. Nicholas, keep your head inside. It's dangerous. He acts as if he doesn't hear me. Keep your head in, I say. It's dangerous. Still he doesn't. I don't care if he's 16 now. I turn around and pull him in myself. I use some force, and then he stays in his seat. The Mediterranean shines so brightly it's impossible to look at it straight on. It floats up through the terrain and calls us like the tunnel of light, the dying sea. Come, become one with my beauty and eternity. I nudge to Frederick's hand, and we'd swerve over the berm and all become weightless again, and then we'd be lifted out of the landscape too. I want to say stop, stop again. Instead, I look at our son. He's having fun. Am I just a killjoy? An oncoming driver lays on his horn. Frederick keeps his eyes fixed on the road before us. They drive like total madmen down here, he says. Will you please drive more slowly, I ask again. Nicholas and Frederick laugh. The road twists, and then we're back in the shadow and close to the rock wall. An oncoming truck suddenly fills the space in front of us. Frederick swings our car up against the rock face. Granite grates against the panels with a sound like we've been tossed in a metal grinder. And then we're past. Frederick says, we took full coverage. The rental agency will cover it all. He doesn't slow down. Now Nicholas pulls on the back of Frederick's seat. Dad, stop, stop. And I join in. Stop the car now. But he doesn't lift his gaze from the road. He sighs like before. I pull back on the handbrake as we drive. He laughs and releases it again. Frederick, look at me. Won't you at least do that? He keeps looking straight ahead as he speaks. And as always, his voice projects reason and calm. I need to keep my eyes on the road. He turns off sharply onto one of the small gravel roads, low dry stone walls on either side, and we skid in the gravel and scream, strike a stone wall, I flung to the other side of the road, hit that wall too, skid, stop. I turn toward Nicholas. I want to be beside him in the back seat, clutch his head to my breast to protect him. But the car's already come to rest, it's too late. Are you okay? But I know he hasn't been hurt. It was only a couple of minor collisions. We're extremely lucky. I close my eyes for a moment and exhale. My pulse is throbbing in my temples. Are you okay? I repeat. Yeah. How about you? I think so. I look out the windshield. Frederick is already out front. He kicks the car with a resentful expression, squats to examine something by one of the fenders. I yell, aren't you even going to see if we're all right? He doesn't answer. Don't you even care? Well, I can see you're doing fine. I jump out the car, and for the first time in our 20 years together, I hit him so hard that it's not just a game. He falls to the gravel, and I shout, what the hell? What the fucking hell? Have you gone stark raving mad? Sweat drips off of me, and my fists are clenched, my pulse still pounding in my temples. He gets up, staggering, but unconcerned, as if he hasn't noticed my blow, and takes a few steps. I don't think I can get it to run. That's a stroke of luck, you big idiot. Maybe we won't die today after all. Mom, Nicholas's voice calls from inside the car. I breathe deeply several times. For my son's sake, I need to be the reasonable one here, and so I manage to pull myself together. What should we do? I ask in a somewhat calm voice. Frederick doesn't answer. He climbs up on the stone wall and stands there surveying the landscape. That's how it begins.
It's hard to know what question to ask because I'm dying to read it now and to find out who all these characters are. But the first thing that strikes me is that it's set in Mallorca. It's set in the Mediterranean.
Well, no. It is a book about a Danish married couple. And what the wife, Mia, soon will learn is that her husband has a brain tumor that has been gradually going for a while and insidiously changing his personality. So he's a very well-respected headmaster of a private school, and everyone respects him, everybody believes everything he does, but he has this tumor located right here. All this is researched with psychiatrists and neurologists and stuff. So he can speak, his intelligence is the same, he can move, but his personality is completely different. And then it is a book with these, like, how do you say, normal scenes about normal people, things that we can all experience. But it is also a book with more philosophical issues of free will, because then it's discovered that a year before this takes place, he started committing fraud against his own private school. So every doctor in the world will agree that as he is now, he could not go to prison because it's his disease. Nobody knows, but it is his disease now. Everyone will agree that 10 years ago, he should go to prison. He is culpable, it's him. But exactly at that gradual slide into who has become now, without anybody noticing, can you say, he's no longer responsible, it's no longer him. So this throws me into a huge search for a neurological knowledge and philosophical knowledge. She has to learn about the whole tradition of Western philosophy and also about how new modern brain science affects it.
And of course, guilt, which is guilt and innocence, and which is
all human emotions, everything that we think we know about how we are, what we are, and what other people are like, will change when you're exposed to something like this. Mm-hmm. And also, in my opinion, a lot of these things will change. For all of us in the coming decades because of the advances in brain science. So if we go back 600 years, for instance, the brightest people on the planet agreed that the solar system, well, it wouldn't be called a solar system, the Earth system. Earth would be in center, outside would be the sun and the moon, the stars at sort of same distance, and further out, God and the angels. Would they all agree that we consist of, I don't know how to put it this in English, but water and fire and soil and what is
the
it?
Elements.
Yeah, the elements. So, and this was as far as you could go. This was philosophy of nature. You did not have science. So you develop or enhance the effectiveness of telescopes and microscopes, and you start to be able to observe these things, and everything is completely thrown away. It's just not true. So right now, we're starting to very, very gradually, long way to go, but we're starting to be able to see into the brain. What does it look like when we're angry, when we make a decision? What does it look like when we're in love? What does it look like to feel you have an identity and to not feel it, to be mentally ill in that way? Things will be completely thrown out, and we have no idea where it's heading. And that's some of what I'm trying to explore in this book about completely normal people. Mm,
that's fascinating. Do we have any questions? That for now, we'll have a Q&A towards the end. Anybody want to go into neurology and character? No? Well, talk, yes?
Just a second. I really...
Sorry. 1 second.
I really enjoyed the reading, so thank you.
Thank you.
I have a question. I don't know, you know, obviously, it's the first time I'm hearing it. So I don't know how deep did you go into this neurology issue, but how long did it take you to do all this research?
I spent almost 5 years writing the book, but that's not exclusive to the research. I love to do research. For me, it's relaxation. For me, writing is it's difficult. It's just pulling out ideas. It's like a constant brainstorm. A book is not one idea. It's an idea for every line of the book. how should I put these words? What should I introduce here? What should I delete? So it's very strenuous. Whereas research is just calming. It's nice. It's relaxation. And in my opinion, the research for this, for a book like this or any other book, should be done to a level where it's not just the fact you need to get right, but where it actually starts to affect your subconscious. So that's also why it's taken me so long to write the book. So I've surrounded myself with spouses of brain damaged people, neurologists. I've been there. I've been to hospitals walking around. I've been allowed inside. And when they did tests of people with this orbitofrontal damage, I've been in the room. I love doing research. I have a way of, also like, for instance, they're both school teachers. So I call up a local school in the neighborhood and said, I'm writing a novel here. One of the characters is a woman teacher. She's around 40 years old. She has a teenage son. She's teaching math and PE. Do you have anybody at your school like that? Oh, we have tons of them. Could you give the one of them that is best at telling stories, the one that Monday morning when she talks about her weekend, everybody wants to listen to, could you give her my phone number? Maybe we can get in touch. So I go out to her home, and I video film everything and interview her about everything and talk to her for hours, and sometimes I become friends with some of these people, and they become my universe in a way to, again, try to so that what I write is from the inside, because it actually becomes my world, and that takes a few years.
Yeah.
I have two questions.
I think for the television, oh, you can have mine for the television.
I have two questions. How did you come up with the idea? I mean, what triggered your interest in this topic? And then about your writing process, when you went around speaking to people, had you already started to write something, or did you explore everything before finding a story?
So I came up with the idea because I have a very close friend back from my school years who is a psychiatrist. And she would always tell me stories about her practice and her work. And it just struck me, these people that she's talking about and her whole view of the world is so different from what I read in fiction. Something is wrong here, I thought. So I have this quite sort of huge challenge for myself. I'm not the one to judge if it succeeded or not, but I've tried to write a book that could be entertaining, but also with a different perspective of what it is to be a person. A perspective that is more in line with recent breakthroughs in psychiatry and neurology. So Mia is entering this world, this is a support group for spouses of brain damage, and everywhere around her, all these people are created not by their past, but by their brain damages. It's just the whole world there. This is the universe you will also enter if you read the book. That was the answer to the first question, and I think I'm taking out a bit of time here now, so we'll close.
Well, no, it's fascinating, and you'll be able to...
But there are other people here, Judith.
Oh.
we have five writers or something.
Thank you.
But anyway, I'll just ask this last one with how I do it. Well, basically, I do everything I can. Sometimes I wake up in the middle of the night, I write, and I have five pages that just... pretty finished. Sometimes I sit struggling on my computer and rewrite for weeks. Sometimes I do research, sometimes I don't. Sometimes I get an idea in the shower. Sometimes I get very often I get an idea at a dinner like this, for instance, and I pretend to go to the toilet and I go out and write it down. Everything is allowed, and it is all one big blend of it all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You have a minute to pass. That bread is really delicious. I was trying to figure out how you do the butter with the bread, because there aren't any forks, but I've been dipping mine in the butter. Okay. I missed the butter knife. Nothing is better than bread this good and butter this good. I realize how rich the evening is, how many interesting things we have to say to each other, and so we're going to go on with the readings, because otherwise we have as Kristen says, so many wonderful writers. We're going to do boy, girl, and we're going to do Scandinavian American, Scandinavian American. A.M. Holmes. Do you have a microphone down there?
I don't, but I better.
You better have to come up here then, because that's where
there's one coming.
It's the runway. It's the runway, so you have to be careful. While you are coming up here, the incredibly distinguished and incredibly prolific A.M. Holmes is the author of This Book Will Save Your Life, which is a novel, Music for Torching, also a novel, The End of Alice, fiction, In a Country of Mothers, novel, and Jack, as well as the short story collections Things You Should Know and The Safety of Objects, and her best-selling memoir, The Mistress's Daughter, as well as a travel memoir, Los Angeles, People, Places, and The Castle on the Hill, and The Artist's Book, Appendix A. Her work has been translated into 22 languages, and I want a question about translation in a minute, not right away, but eventually. And appears in art form, Harper's, Granta, McSweeney's, The New Yorker, The New York Times, and Zoetrope. She's a contributing editor to Vanity Fair, to Bomb, and to Blind Spot, and if you are not cool enough to know what they are, there is no hope for you. I don't know it. Several times a year, she collaborates on book projects with artists, and some of the most distinguished younger artists in the world, Eric Fischel, Rachel White-Reed, Cecily Brown, Bill Owens, Julie Speed, and others. She's also a very big media, television, script, film person. She's created television pilots for HBO, FX, and CBS. She was a writer-producer of the Showtime series The L Word.
I know, taxes.
She doesn't do taxes. Do you cook?
Yeah, I can cook, if pressed.
Do you do windows?
Badly.
Okay.
But I do.
And so forth and so forth. And she's won more awards that you can name, including a Guggenheim Foundation Award, an NEA Award, a Kalman Center Scholarship, which is really prestigious and quite elite, and so forth and so forth. And what are you reading tonight?
Well, you know, I completely changed my mind after your introduction.
Oh.
Now I'm reading from The Great Gatsby. No, I was thinking about the whole notion of Babette's feast and Denison, Blixen, and I was thinking about the memoir somehow and personal stories, and then all of a sudden we sat at this table and I thought, a feast! And I completely changed what I'm going to read. So I'm going to read just a little bit in the interest of time from the beginning of the novel, May We Be Forgiven, if that's okay.
Please.
And I'll leave the electron microscope. No, it's okay. It's pointless anyway. It's all conceptual. Okay. May we be forgiven. An incantation. A prayer. The hope that somehow I come out of this alive. Was there ever a time you thought, I'm doing this on purpose. I'm fucking up and I don't know why. Do you want my recipe for disaster? The warning sign. Last year, Thanksgiving at their house. 20 or 30 people at tables spreading from the dining room into the living room, stopping abruptly at the piano bench. He was at the head of the table, picking turkey out of his teeth, talking about himself. I kept watching him as I went back and forth carrying plates into the kitchen, the edges of my fingers dipping into unnameable goo, cranberry sauce, sweet potato, cold pearl onion, gristle. With every trip back and forth from the dining room to the kitchen, I hated him more. Every sin of our childhood, beginning with his birth, came back. He entered the world 11 months after me, sickly at first, not enough oxygen along the way, and was given far too much attention. And then, despite what I repeatedly tried to tell him about how horrible he was, he acted as though he believed he was a gift of the gods. They named him George. Geo, he liked to be called. Like that was something cool, scientific, analytical. Geode, I called him, like a sedimentary rock. By the time we were 10 and 11, he was taller than me, broader, stronger. Are you sure he's not the butcher's boy? My father would ask jokingly, and no one laughed. I was bringing in heavy plates and platters, casseroles caked with the debris of dinner, and no one noticed that help was needed. Not George, not his two children, not his ridiculous friends, who were in fact in his employ, among them a weather girl and assorted spare anchor men and women who sat stiff-backed, hairsprayed like Ken and Barbie, and not my Chinese-American wife, Claire, who hated turkey and never failed to remind us that her family used to celebrate with roast duck and sticky rice. George's wife, Jane, had been at it all day, cooking, cleaning, serving, and was now scraping bones into a giant trash bin. Jane scoured the plates, piling dirty dishes one on top of the other, dropping the slimy silver into a sink of steaming water. Glancing at me, she brushed her hair away with the back of her hand and smiled. I went back for more. I looked at their children and imagined them dressed as pilgrims in black buckle shoes, doing pilgrim children chores, carrying buckets of milk like human oxen. Nathaniel, 12, and Ashley, 11, sat like lumps at the table, hunched, or more like curled as if poured into their chairs, truly spineless, eyes focused on their small screens, the only thing in motion, their thumbs. One texting friends no one had ever seen, the other killing digitized terrorists. In the background, two televisions loudly competed for no one's attention, one featuring football, the other the film Mighty Joe Young. You know, I'm a company man, heart and soul. I'm the network's president of entertainment. I am ever aware 24/7, George said. There's a television in every room. The fact is, George can't bear to be alone, not even in the bathroom. The turkey platter was at the center of the table. I reached over my wife's shoulder and lifted. The tray was heavy and wobbled, and I willed myself to stay strong and carry out the mission while balancing a casserole with Brussels sprouts and bacon in the crook of my other arm. The turkey was an heirloom bird, whatever that means, but it had been rubbed, herbed, relaxed into submission, into thinking it wasn't so bad to be decapitated and stuffed up the ass with breadcrumbs and cranberries in some annual rite. The bird had been raised with a goal in mind, an actual date. I stood in the kitchen picking at the carcass while Jane did the dishes, bright blue gloves on up to her elbows and suds. My fingers were deep in the bird, the hollow body still warm, the best bits of stuffing packed in. I dug with my fingers and brought stuffing to my lips. Jane looked at me, my mouth moist, greasy, my fingers curled into what would have been the turkey's G-spot if they had such things. She lifted her hands out of the water and came towards me to plant one on me. Not friendly. The kiss was serious, full of desire. It was terrifying and unexpected. She did it, then snapped off her gloves and walked out of the room. Dessert was served. Jane asked if anyone wanted coffee and went back into the kitchen. I followed her like a dog wanting more. She ignored me. "Are you ignoring me?" I asked. She said nothing and handed me the coffee. "Could you let me have a little pleasure, a little something that's just for myself?" She paused. "Cream and sugar?" It's an aperitif.
Yes, well, this is the great tradition of the family.
Yes.
The family reveal all. The family reveal all occasions.
All families do reveal all. That's the.
Is that your experience? Mine never said a word to anybody.
Isn't that so revealing?
Well, we want to know what happens actually.
Well, what happens? It's that's just the beginning. There's a horrible moment coming soon where George is kind of a head case. He's this network president of entertainment. He's a man who's, I would say, alternately fat and thin. He has a whole closet full of suits of different sizes. He's alternately a drug addict and then not. And he's in a sort of an accident, a bad accident. Some people are killed. And it's not clear if it really was an accident or George just thought a red light didn't apply to him. And while he's in the hospital, Harry accidentally sleeps with Jane. And of course, George comes home. And then what to me was always interesting is that George kills Jane, not Harry. And it's really a novel, and it takes off from there. I'm not giving anything away,
because
it's just a few pages from now. And then it becomes this rollicking black comedy about family life and Richard Nixon.
Oh, Nixon. That's always
Nixon.
That's
Nixon's
funny.
Deeply
He's
embedded.
Very funny.
Yes. Harold is a Nixon scholar who's fired because professors and colleges are more thinking that history is more future forward and not so interested in the past.
Well, one thing I also wanted to ask Kristen and wanted to ask everybody in different ways, the translation, I mean, you write in English, this is in English, but you translate your work into many genres. And so you do all these different forms of writing.
Right.
And it's partly about roots and roots and identity and various other things. How does your voice change? I mean, you've been translated into millions of languages.
Sure.
Can you read yourself in any of the languages that you've been translated into? Not really.
No, but you know, the funny thing is that truthfully, from the very beginning, and I've been writing since I was 19, so my first novel, Jack, won a German Literature Prize that had only previously been won by people named Josef, I think, actually. There was no AM anywhere in the history of that. And to me, the foreign translations have actually meant more than the American publications, because it means that the work has meaning and resonance in other countries, in other cultures, in other languages, and that to me is incredible. We had one with the book that, this book will save your life, other people call it the donut book, because a lot of countries had donuts on the cover. And in Korea, they wanted to put a Dunkin' Donut coupon in the book. And Andrew Wiley, who's someone, you know, the Sharky agent, our agent, yes, he's like, you know, he's absolutely not. We will not put coupons in the books. And I was like, let them put the coupon in the book.
Yes.
Because I thought the idea of a Dunkin' Donut coupon in Korea in a book, in a literary book, go for it. I just thought it was so, you know, that's
really fabulous. What
it's about.
It's fantastic.
I don't know that it's so.
If you did that here, you would have maybe more policemen would read the book.
Or eat the book. It's really hard to know. Yeah. But I like that. And I also, the truth is, there's nothing more remarkable to open a book, translate it into another language, and look at it and think, I have no idea what it says. And then there's certain things that don't transfer, like the name Jennifer. It'll be completely in, like, you know, the hieroglyphics of another language, and then it just says Jennifer. And I love looking at that, too. I find that, I don't know. It's hugely comic to me only, probably.
Jennifer, yeah, well, they're also, I love the way that names also become obsolete.
Well,
I mean, you did the right thing. Your name will never become obsolete because...
I took the lesson, actually, from, it was Andy Warhol who told me to be AM. Yeah, because Andy Warhol talked about Andy Warhol as a brand in the sense that there's a space between whatever A.M. Holmes is and me. And I always liked that, and it is just this other thing.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
So are there people who are grandfathered in who call you Susie or whatever your real name is?
No, that's the funny joke. Salman, who everyone else does, calls me Amy. Nobody calls me Amy, but I can't bring myself to tell Salman, nobody calls me Amy. Like, not even my mother.
There are a few people, I'm very much older than you are, there are a few people grandfathered in who can call me Judy.
Oh, really? Yeah.
But they're dying at very quickly.
Yeah.
The naming thing is
no,
really
and it was really, and also I used to put, you know, it's
but how are you not old enough to have known Andy Warhol?
Yes, he
is. Yeah, I actually, I studied art history, it was my first sort of love, and I once made this Andy Warhol collage, and he was coming to Washington, where I grew up, Washington, D.C., and I brought this enormous collage of, like, Warhol-style thing to show him. I'm like, look, Andy, look what I made. And he took out a marker and he signed it. And I thought, that is
so
weird.
Do you have it? Do you still have it?
I have pieces of it, and I have all these Polaroids of him that he signed, and me and Andy and whatever, and it's like, you know.
Questions? Yes?
Yeah.
Oh, I have one. Oh. Hi. I've just finished this book. It's wonderful. And I found it really compelling that you, as a woman, wrote from the male point of view. Not only that, but it is written in the first person from Harry's point of view, and you kill off Jane, George's wife, early, and then you have Claire, Harry's Chinese wife, divorce Harry early. So the female characters are really pretty non-existent, whereas the male, I mean, my question is you seem to be very facile, very at ease in the male voice, and I just wondered what, how that comes about, or whether it was whether it was difficult at all, talk about that a little bit.
I mean, I think the two things I would say is that for me this was really a book about brothers and about family and about that sort of almost biblical kind of Cain and Abel tug of war. So the women weren't the focus of it, which I'm actually surprised, you know, it won this Women's Literature Prize in England, and I thought, that's amazing because
right.
I killed the woman
and
it's all about these brothers. I thought, that's great. Because I really didn't expect that.
It's also been called a great American novel, I think, right?
You know, it turns out great American novel just means large American novel. It's not actually a quality thing. But anyway, in terms of the male voice, I think it goes back to, I really am, except for when I'm purposely writing memoir or anything autobiographical, which I actually hate doing, and I was going to read from the memoir, and the truth is, I think it's perfectly fine, but it's excruciating. And I love inhabiting people who are other than myself. To me, there's nothing more uninteresting than writing about a woman who's around my age. I think, I am around my age. You know, what's so interesting? You know,
I'm not around my age.
Yeah, I have a hard time. So I like, And that, to me, it's also like the greatest compliment when men read the book and they go, how do you know that? And I think, you know, and I do a lot of research. It's the research.
Including thing, sexual you know. Things.
Well, everything. I love it. I mean, what could be more fun? I also they did a lot of internet research for the weird internet sex dating thing. And I would just like to say, you cannot make that up. It's all fact-based, whatever's in there.
One more question, and then we're going to, we have so much more.
We have so many callers on the line.
Callers. Yes, so many callers are on the line. Elizabeth in Trenton, New Jersey.
Any more questions?
Thank you so much.
Pass bottles in whatever direction they need to be passed and bred and this and that. If you could actually pass the bread this way. I know. Thomas Bannerhead. Thomas, where are you sitting? Ah, okay. Thomas Bannerhead. Did I say it right, more or less? Bannerhead? Thomas was born in 1966 in a small village called Uraso. How do you say it? Urosa. In the province of Småland, in southern Sweden, which is a very wild and beautiful place. And he now lives in Stockholm. In 2011, his debut novel, The Ravens, was awarded the prestigious Swedish August Prize, the best book of the year prize, and has since received several other prizes. It has been sold in 7 countries, including the Great Britain, France, and Germany. And the first UK edition was published in the spring of this year by the Clerkenwell Press. And he will be reading a piece from The Ravens. Thomas, on ahead.
Thank you for the invitation. It's an honor to be here in this big city. I'm going to read 2 pages from the first chapter in this book. And very shortly, the book is about a poor Swedish farming family in the late 70s. And it's about mental illness and birds. Birds.
Birth as in being born?
No, birds.
Birds.
There's father, I thought, in his eternal cloud, bouncing along in grandfather's old Ferguson with his body belt drawn tight and his hair growing grayer. And later he'll come home smelling of earth, because he has no choice, because this spot is ours, this plot of soil, these acres of farmland. The lake drained and turned into fields and banks, the marsh, Ravenfen, smoking like ashes and tinder as soon as the dry season sets in. The peat bog that can suddenly catch fire, smoldering and gasping in its depth, burning without the flame, glowing unseen, consuming everything from below until you dig trenches to cut it off. This is our patch. We have no other. This soil, observed by the sun and the ravens. I nipped a leaf off the lightning aspen and sat there holding it in my pathetic girl's hand. Compared the 2 sides of the leaf, studied the long flattened stalk, the superfine tracery of its veins, the irregular divisions of its blade, like aerial photos of paddy fields in faraway lands. The fresh leaf with its luminous green nerve fibers, as thin and fragile as the capillaries of an eyelid. I leant forward and sniffed it, put it on my tongue, and took it into my mouth like a communion wafer. The aspen and me, I thought, the least thing makes us shake. Homo tremula, that's me. I gave a start. The tractor heading this way and no roller. So it's dinner time. The hour has struck. Soon they assemble in silence round the table and say a short grace. Those heavy eyes on you, like something pulling at you. You stay here, the voice ordered. You're not to be owned by anyone, not even the person who begot you. Today is today. You can do as you will. Walk, see, feel, listen. It's what you exist for. I held the aspen leaf up to the sun, brought it gradually closer to my eye, little by little, and the veins turned into rivers spreading across a foreign land, waterways with the natives paddling along in hollowed out tree trunks among lethal caimans, rivers winding through steaming jungles where harpy eagles rose from the treetops with baby monkeys and sloths in their claws, sweeping off like their primeval counterparts on vast spreads of wing. Again, I was jolted back to reality. Father was sounding his horn, a long, insistent signal, as if he knew where I was and wanted to show me who was who. Today's not just any old day. You are you and I am me, and I'll come when it suits me to the place you lot call home. From a tree stump with 100 rings. If he drives the tractor into the canal, it's your fault. You'll have to live with it for the rest of your life.
So powerful. Did you start out as a poet?
Pardon?
Did you start out as a poet? What did you start writing when you started out?
I started as a journalist.
Oh, that's unromantic.
And I was also working as a university teacher for many years, so it was a late debut. Uh-huh. I felt I had to write something that meant more than the journalism.
I hear you. Yes. Who was who? Yes.
You know, journalism is about the big world, but I'm more interested in the small world, the feelings and the relations. And then literature is a good thing.
Did you just walk away? Or did you wean yourself off journalism a little bit by bit?
Well, I had to leave the old work and do this story.
Mm-hmm. Were you terrified to do that?
Terrified?
Yes.
It was like an obsession, uh-huh. Maybe. And I worked with it for 10 years because I had no language and I had no story.
What do you mean you had no language?
I'm a social scientist from the beginning and had never read so much and knew very little about literature. But I was obsessed by telling this story about mental illness and birds, and I made a lot of research to get everything right. And
well, when you started reading, when you started becoming a literary writer, whom did you read?
Who?
Yeah.
Mostly Norwegian and Swedish writers.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know them, but my favorite writer is a Norwegian called Tarjei Vesaas. Oh.
So this is your first novel?
Yes. Yes.
Bravo! Wonderful. Yes, it's funny. questions for Tomas? Yes. Oh, okay. Whatever. The order doesn't matter. Yes, go ahead.
I have a question about the birds. I'm curious to find out what's the point of what is the role of the birds? Is it more like the journalist, like the observer in your novel? Can you tell me a bit about the birds?
This farming family, this home, is not a good place for the boy. And he feels more happy among the birds than among the human beings. So it's his obsession by the birds, which is the point. And he learns all about birds, and he tries to live with the birds in the forest. And there he feels free. In his own family, he never feels free. It's about the father. The big thing is that the father wants his oldest son to take over the farm. And this oldest son, he hates it. And then he escapes to the birds in the forest. So that's why all these hundreds of birds in the novel.
You said you had no story, but an obsession. What was the obsession, and where did it come from?
Maybe it had to do with an attempt to understand my own life. When I was maybe 9 or 10 years, I felt I was born in the wrong place in the world, very strongly. And place. And then when I grew older, I felt more and more that I had to try to understand why I felt so strongly that I was born in the wrong place.
So that was the obsession?
Yes, to try to understand myself and my own life.
Yes. You get this first.
And then the novel is much about shame and guilt. The shame has to do with the mental illness. If you grow up in a family with mental illness and you never talk to it, it's like a big cloud of shame around it. And the guilt has to do with that the son hates the work that his parents live from. Yeah.
Yes, I'm interested in the symbolism of the raven. That's been a sign of death and foreboding in most of the Scandinavian countries, and even in America with Edgar Allan Poe's The Raven. And if there was something symbolic about the ravens, particularly as birds, or this is also another kind of a metaphor or some kind of a internal symbol of what was happening.
Both things, I think. The ravens are the most intelligent birds.
Yes, I've heard.
And they also symbolize death. And in this novel, the father, when he is psychotic, sometimes, he hears the ravens in his head, only inside his head. The ravens scream in his head. So he turns mad. So therefore the title from... that's not so many ravens actually in the story, but this inside his head is very strong.
In English there's also the raving and raven. Raving is to be mad and to be... To be raving is to...
Okay.
Sort of,
yes. I didn't know.
There's also. Well, Tomas, thank you so much. Really
thank you.
We're moving along because the evening is so rich that there's less time than I was worried about the hour and a half, and it's just rushing by. Our next reader is one of Iceland's greatest writers, Steinun Sigurðardóttir, and she's going to pronounce her own name for us much better than I will. She is a native of Reykjavik. She studied philosophy and psychology in Ireland at the University of Dublin. She made her debut as a writer at 19 with a volume of poetry called Continuances. She's since become one of Iceland's most frequently translated writers and one of the most lauded, having won every prize in the book, from the Icelandic Literature Prize for her Place of the Heart and the National Booksellers Prize, among many others. She's also an incredibly prolific and virtuosic genre shifter as a writer. She's written 11 novels, 7 volumes of poetry, 2 volumes of short stories, plays for radio and television, and a children's book. Good evening.
Good evening. I think I came up too early. My mind was drifting. I hope it doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't matter. We're drifting tonight, especially after our fourth lesson.
So thank you. Place of the Heart, my freshly published novel, which I hold to my heart, is the first of my novels to be published in the English-speaking world. And this is my first presentation of the novel in English, so this is a very special occasion for me. Well, I don't have a glass, and schnapps is too much at this stage, thank you.
Well, let's get her a glass.
We must not toast in water. No, no, that brings bad luck. No, no.
It's coming.
Yes, let's absolutely. We must get this right. Thank you.
A first book in English and a first presentation of
well,
a book.
Well, maybe I should mix red and white. Thank you.
Regalek.
In Icelandic we say skál. Thank you. I'm sure one is not supposed to drink to oneself, but I've done that too, you know.
So we're drinking to the book.
Yes, thank you. So this miracle of a publication is thanks to my brilliant Amazonians, Amazon Crossing, and it's an honor for me that the publisher Sarah Jane Gunter is here tonight, as well as my editor Gabriella Page Faure, with whom I have enjoyed an exemplary cooperation for which I am deeply grateful. Place of the Heart, this icebreaker of my work in the English-speaking world, is made up of many stories and many characters, a lot of Icelandic landscape, and a few other ingredients. The frame of the novel looks like a road movie, 3 women in a white pickup truck, and a 4th blind passenger, the dead mother of the main character, Harpa. My main character is a young woman who has a teenage daughter, Edda. She is so self-destructive that her mother sets out to rescue her by moving to the place of the heart, out east, the countryside. If you were to ask me why I wrote the novel, I would say out of love for the nature of my country, out of love for the young ones, and perhaps more importantly, out of fear for both. In Germany, the novel was described as the Iceland novel, filling in all the gaps. I hope that's true. In any case, it was written well before Iceland became all the rage amongst celebrities, Hollywood film directors, and common tourists. Place of the Heart was written while we Icelanders had the place all to ourselves. And I could not have possibly imagined that most of the places described in my novel would 20 years later have been exploited as big time film locations, Game of Thrones, Secret Life of Walter Mitty, and Noah, most notably. And in this incredibly beautifully produced book, you can trace those places by looking at the graphic maps at the beginning of the book. So it's a difficult task to choose a piece to read. This novel has so many different ingredients, so many moods, but I decided to go ahead with the absurd conversations that my main character has with her dead mother. The chapter is called, I must get this right, The Garden of Fog. It's towards the end of the book. She has reached the place of the heart. And in Icelandic, the Garden of Fog is Þokugarðurinn. Come on then, I say, as I open the gate. Lubbi the dog plods happily into the good garden where he and Mom and Edda had seen better days. Isn't that why one lives? To have seen better days. Not here, Mom, no way. Where do you want me to be then? Nowhere, Mom. Just stay in your place. I have other things to bother about than to carry your millstone. Be sweet to me, Harpa baby. Do you remember when we spent entire days here together, rooting in the dirt? You helped me pull weeds and do the watering when you were just a chubby little thing. Yeah, yeah. You always were such a good girl. Then why didn't you love me if I was so good? I do love you, but I guess I'm bad at showing it. Leave me alone. Let me think in peace. You can't refuse to take a little stroll with your mother on old paths. I sit down on a rock beneath a birch tree whose hanging branches protect me from the drizzle. Mom hovers over me with a hand on her hip. She's wearing checkered wool trousers and has an old backpack on her back. Mom, why don't you help me instead of following me around? I can't go on. I don't want to exist, small and ugly as I am. I don't know how to live. I wish I'd never been born and you won't let me be. How can you be so awful? Be careful what you say, little Harpa. You yourself are awful. You never show me any sympathy. Poor me, who died before my time. It's been 10 years, Mom, a whole decade. Of course it was a shock for you, I admit that, but isn't it time that you pull yourself together and try to get over it? A shock for me to die? You're funny, dear. Okay, a turning point. You should start writing obituaries for people. Mom laughs dryly and has a coughing fit. Did you forget your cigarettes? I say. Why don't you blow smoke in my face like you're used to doing on this jaunt of yours around Iceland? I bet it's illegal for you to be here. Do you have a passport? Mom looks at me in surprise, stopping in mid-cough. You know what, Mom? After only a few hours, everything will be out in the open. I'm on my way to ask Aunt Dýrfinna who my father is. Then you and your promiscuity will be exposed. You're one to talk. You've already slept with more men than I'll ever manage. What, for example, were you doing last night? I'm free as a bird. I don't have to explain my actions. My word. Mom, let's make peace, even if it's too late. I think we would have become friends if time had allowed. Things might have been decent between us now if you hadn't died. But you see how it is. You get in my way and we're still fighting. Mom fishes a tattered green checkered thermos flask from her backpack and pours coffee into a plastic cup. I take a sip, but it's the same old Braga coffee. I don't want to insult her by criticizing it, though, so I use the cup to warm my hands. All of a sudden, Lubbi is at my side, barking softly. Isn't that our Lubbi? Says Mom. Woof, he says. alone in grandma's grove with a decrepit dog and a stone dead mother. Is it possible to be more bereft than this? A tear rolls down my cheek, down my left cheek, just like my friend Gabriel Axel in Perpignan. What saves us is oftentimes the same thing that casts us into ruin, says Mom. Should I write that down? I stop looking at her as she hovers over me in her old traveling clothes. She appears to me to have grown younger, but I say nothing about it and look down, and the black boots I'm wearing in the wet grass, the boots of a child, yet too big for me. They're becoming a part of nature, covered with ears of couch grass blades. If I sit long enough, the soles of my shoes will become glued to the grass. Moss will grow over me from top to bottom. My bottom will fuse with the rock. And 1,000 years later, children will come and say, there's the ogress who turned to stone, and the rock next to her is her old dog. She was talking to her mother, who was a ghost, and didn't watch out for the dawn. But her mom just vanished into thin air because she no longer existed anyway. The children will sit in my lap. I, who was once a person and an assistant nurse. They won't know what my name was, Harpa Hernandezdóttir Eir, or that I had a daughter very young, and that it wasn't known what would happen to this daughter. But at least an attempt was made to rescue her from bad company and take her to the Eastfjords, and that it was precisely on that trip that the woman turned to stone, and she was very glad, because there was nothing ahead of her but damned hardship. But no one knew this except for her while she lived. Thank you.
Do we ever escape from our ghosts? Do we ever escape from our families? I mean, so many of the writers...
Well, I'm not dead yet, so I don't know. But in any case, the book, of course, is very much about the infamous mother-daughter relationship, as you've heard.
Wait,
both,
sorry?
Both famous and infamous, yes.
Do you have a daughter?
Of course I do.
Since you're so fluent in English and studied in Ireland, you can read this English translation really not on top of the level of the snow, but getting into it. What does it feel like to read yourself reified in another language that you actually speak perfectly?
Now, to be quite honest with you, I am very glad that I get this question, because I live in Germany and it is my sideline to deconstruct my work in German, in French, in Swedish, in Danish when I get the chance. And I am absolutely thrilled that I am finally allowed to use my English, which is always better than any other of my, than all the other of my foreign languages, because I did study in Dublin. And I'm very glad about what you're saying. But what it is wonderful, though, that people can be so appreciative, you know, that when you stumble on in a language that you are not, absolutely not perfect in, as my German. But I'm doing readings all over, but the difference for me is huge to be able to present my work in English.
But when you read your sentences, these are sentences that have come out of your flesh, because they do out of every writer's flesh, and they are written in Icelandic, and now they are in English. Is there a strange sense of impersonation? Is there a strange sense? I'm just looking for that strange, it's happened to me, I'm sure you've given a million interviews in which your words are translated into another language, but with your own writing, it's more, I would think, visceral, and since I know you can read it at the deepest level, what does that feel like?
Well, I'm not always very good at answering questions directly, but...
you can say, I don't know.
Yes. Well, there is, and this is an indirect answer, there is a world of difference between the original text and the translation. I have huge luck with my translators, but I still think that the translated book is another book, and which is very lucky because it means that we have far more books in the world than hitherto thought, since they're all new books. A lot of it has to do with the music of the language. I started out as a poet, and I am always using, I use the methods of the poet to write my novels, which is a very painstaking process. So I don't think that even with any amount of work and dedication, it would be absolutely possible to catch exactly what I'm doing. But that said, translators are my heroes in life. What incredible work they are able to perform in a short time under pressure with scant reward.
Are there any questions? Yes.
What do you mean by using the method of a poet to write a novel?
I mean that a poet is, a poem is something that you can, normally if it's a poem of a normal length, it's something that you can, it's überschaubar in German, you can, you have a complete view of the poem simply because you can embrace it. Now it's much more difficult to embrace a novel with all these words. One question is a question of the quantity of words. And when you try to keep them under as close control as you do in a poem, I mean using the methods of the poet, but it has also a deeper meaning. I think definitely that my fantasy is the fantasy of the poet. I do not do research.
One more question. Yes.
I just finished your book, and I was wondering if the character Gabriel Axel had come from Isaac Dinesen.
Yeah, you know, this is quite funny because, if I may also use a detour here, you said something about Isaac Dinesen bringing consolation. That is not my aim at all. I think we are all inconsolable. And but the name of Gabriel Axel is, I knew, of course, very well what I was doing when I took the name, because the guy he had filmed in Iceland, I knew him, long before he became famous. I mean, not personally, but his work. And I love this film and I admire it. But I took the name because Gabriel Axel is a special constellation. It has a meaning for me, which I don't necessarily want to go into. But it's, if you take a look at the names and they're, what they might mean, you might be able to understand. But when I found out that Gabriel Axel, the Danish film, the director, had moved to Perpignan, where he actually is living in the book, I read that somewhere, I decided this is too much. I'm not going to do research and see is he actually living in Perpignan or not. Because I had no idea of this thing.
I also just have to add that I am a common tourist to your country, and I have fallen in love with it. But I've never been to the East Fjords, and so my next trip, it was as much a character in the book as everything else, and I have to take a trip there now.
I'm very glad that you say that. I have heard a lot of people say that the landscape is a living person in the book. And, my strongest memories are the memories when I was a child, when I was alone in nature, not in the East Fjords. They are not my place of the heart. My place of the heart is in the southeast to the west of the big glacier. But the trip there takes only one day, and I needed 2 days. Mm-hmm. So I borrowed the place of the heart of my best friend. Ah.
That's a wonderful.
Thank you.
We are going to conclude this guestabug, this festin, with Bob Holman. Bob is a performer, professor, impresario, activist, proprietor of the Bowery Poetry Club, filmmaker, and soon-to-be host, yes, absolutely, of a PBS special on endangered languages, which is a mutual passion of ours. That's just his day job. He's really just a poet.
That's right.
He's a great student of the oral tradition. He studied the origins of hip-hop in West Africa, and that led to his current work, which is illuminating the crisis brought on by language death. And language, like species, is becoming different. Languages are becoming extinct day by day. He's the co-founder and co-director of the Endangered Language Alliance. His new collection, Sing This One Back to Me, will be released in May. No, it's been released.
It was released last May.
Last May, sorry, by the Coffee House Press. And I love this. In Wales, Bob competed in the national
Eisteddfod, right,
the world's oldest poetry slam, and he did it in Welsh.
That's right. Yeah, as a matter of fact, I've also, like Amy, am changing my whole, what I sent you, Judith. I am going to do this, the poem that I did then, which happens to be in this book. And you know, the Eisteddfod means a lot of people just sitting around together. Sitting down is what poetry was about. Not only that generally you sit down to write the poem, but also that if you won the prize at the Eisteddfod, what you won was a seat at the table with the lords. Like, here I am, hello, singing for my supper, Babette's feast. What an ironic title, huh? And what the winner of the Eisteddfod receives is a chair, a hand-carved chair to take home with them. So, and you know, to sit at whatever table they can find. That's been going on since 1187. I wasn't competing for the chair. I was in the stomp, which is the Welsh version of the poetry slam. And the winner of the stomp does not receive a chair, instead receives a stool. So, but here it is. This is the first poem I wrote on Welsh, and I'm going to interpolate some English here so you can get at it. It's called Foche Homa Dwin Fochendoskir Fochen Gumraig Diener Titel. Now, Welsh has very few curse words, but when they use them, they generally grab them from the English. One of the reasons why this language has survived is it's been able to use what it needs, taking it from the millions of English speakers right across the border, right? There's 3 million people in Wales, 600,000 of them are speaking Welsh. So I thought I would get right in with the judges at the stomp by showing that I was a true Welshman from the north of Wales, which is where the Welsh is most spoken, and where cursing is most prevalent. Not down south in Cardiff or Cardiff, but up north where I was in Blaenafestiniog and other places. The title I read was actually, Fuck Off, I'm a Fucking Welsh Fucking Learner. That's the title. Now, how to get over with the Welsh judges, I thought, was to start off with this line. Ruin Timlo Veli Hraigochun Hangoli Freuda. You know that on the Welsh flag, there is a red dragon. And the red, it's the only red dragon on a flag at the United Nations. The red dragon is underground, as is the white dragon, waiting for the next battle to come up, when the red dragon of Wales is going to come up and take over the white dragon. I don't know whether Brits allow that to still be on the flag, but there it is. So I say, I feel like the red dragon in the middle of battle. Barth Americanae tumfat unhang orli stomp. A stupid American poet in the middle of the stomp. Isiae im the hiriad din possibiliad, isiae ingaviriad din the finiad o virhuediad, a destruiniar the finiad. Want an apology? No possibility. My address, the contradiction of definition. Definition, demolition. Oh, in gochira vonungi, my ungubot. Bethidur tia minyao fraud, ut suppus germaun guswig ugnaud. Old river boatman death, he knows it. What art thou and I, brother, but this uniform of bones and flesh? Tikuid chinchau y chod ar echufarodi ar R. Williams Perry, a T.H. Perry Williams, in no imperialis Americanaith. The above lines were stolen on your behalf from R. Williams Perry and T.H. Perry Williams in the name of American imperialism. You know, I thought by dropping in these famous lines of Welsh poetry, not only would I be engaging in appropriation, which of course is the most popular contemporary American poetic school, but also letting the Welsh feel that I was going to try to get away with using these great lines myself, being of course just another American imperialist poet taking stealing the lines. Fonadigian upon the Gessiae, Fichinir Gintov, Ogen Haneth. Ladies and gentlemen, my first line in Canhaneth. Now, one reason why Welsh has lasted these centuries is because Welsh poetry has its own poetic devices that you won't find in any other language. The Canhaneth. The Canhaneth can best be translated as consonant chime. It's, you take a line of your poetry, divide it in the middle with your caesura, like you're gonna do, and then the first part of the line and the second part of the line, take out the vowels, the consonants chime with each other. The ka, the, la, and the could all be mirrored on both sides. Maybe there's some rhyme in there too. Five different ways of doing Canhaneth. But if you speak Welsh, it's not like when we hear a sonnet, we kind of might feel that that might be a sonnet. If it's written Petrarchan or Shakespearean, you might hear a rhyme scheme going on or something. But the Welsh know their Canhaneth, and they hear the consonants chime. So once again, having learned my slam at the New Eureka Poets Cafe, I know how to get over with an audience is to speak that lingo. So here is my first line of Canhaneth. First in Welsh again, Vichinath, oh no, wait a second, in Ischgrid in Vesger. Did you hear it? In Ischgrid. In the Esgen. It's tough to hear it in English. It goes, in English it's translated, shaking in my bones. It's true, you know, I am shaking in my bones. And you know why? Because I'm up here at the stomp and I'm just a fucking Welsh fucking learner. That's why. Baby, baby, yr unig ffordd o atal I gerthon, I cwsna, cwsna, Lle mae pob cwsyn I lod yn air Gymraeg, yn fy main aelond a ffroedwydion. Baby, baby, The only way to stop this poem is to kiss, kiss, where each kiss becomes a word in Welsh, in my big head of dreams.
Well, the original Babette's feast went on late, late into the night when all of these old Puritans just drank some champagne without knowing what it was. I wish we could go on late, late, late into the night, too. We're already going later into the night. I just have so many questions for you, our mutual passion for endangered languages being part of it. Okay, how did you learn Welsh? Who are you?
The Welsh is the only language that's been on the official endangered list and then come off. How did they do that? And in the midst of the poem, I gave you some, you know, that they're keeping up with poetic traditions like the slam while still maintaining their own back from the 12th century. They are allowing English words to come in. They're no purists about it, especially curse words, but other words as well. For example, round the corner. Round the corner means, you know, you go around the corner. You know, you need a word like that, and English is pretty good at it. So they just round the corner in Welsh. But they also have these heritage centers, I can't believe I'm forgetting my marvelous place where I studied, but they have heritage centers where you can go, adults can go and learn the language. A big problem there is that the property values in Wales is less than that in England. So you find the English coming over and buying summer homes in places that used to be of the Welsh tradition. And now they're bringing English with them as summer people. Some of the summer people realize where they're going and decide to learn the language or give it a stab, you know. One thing that you learn when you find out about the fact that half the 7,000 languages on Earth are going to disappear in the next 50 or 60 years unless we start to pay as much attention to languages as we do to endangered species of plants and animals, is that the answer is in keeping mother tongues alive at home, to allowing the respect of the smaller languages to continue, and let the parents know that their children will not be hindered in becoming part of the bully culture if they speak this language with the parents. They're still going to watch television and walk out on the street and pick up English or whatever the language is there. And in
what's your family? What's your ethnic background?
Well, my mom married the only Jew in Harlan, Kentucky. You know, which meant that she was a coal miner's daughter, Lewis.
She had a Geiger counter. Yeah.
She was a Lewis, which is one of the five names you can be in Wales. You know, Jones. Right. You know, is number one, but Lewis and Thomas come in as two and three. So I do have Welsh blood. So there was part of it. The other part's from Ukraine, by the way, or what we call Ukraine.
Yes. Questions for, what's your name in Welsh?
Oh, I don't have a Welsh name. I don't know what it would be. No, I believe it's about the same. Robert Holman, you know, Bob.
So pretty much everybody tonight except Ian Holmes comes from a small language culture. You know?
I come from small language.
What? Yeah. You don't?
I do.
What?
Latvia and Russia and Germany and yeah.
Well, but you that's true. But you also you have your own minoritarian concerns, so you definitely.
Well, I think that if everybody scratches back, that's a great thing about the supposed monoglot U.S. is that you scratch back a couple of generations, you will discover, as everybody has here, that who you are really has a lot to do with these languages that are there, whether they're Latvian or, in my case, Ukrainian and Yiddish, you know. And, you know, this great, we could go on and on about Yiddish and Ladino, you know, and other Jewish languages that are Hebrew, which miraculously was brought back after 700 years of non-use, is an example of how a language can survive if there's the dynamism there to do it.
Questions for Bob, and then we're going to have a little ending, not ceremony, but a little ending. Yes?
Hi, have you looked into Yiddish as well, along with your sort of
Absolutely.
Welsh
well, Yiddish, yeah, I made a program, it's on Link TV, about Yiddish and Ladino. You know, it's not a pretty story. Of course, the Hasids keep Yiddish alive, but it's not the Yiddish of Shalom Aleichem. You know, it's not the Yiddish of the 30s here in New York, when there were six daily Yiddish newspapers, and the rise of Hebrew is at the expense of Yiddish. Now, the Holocaust, of course, was what dealt the major blow against Yiddish. Still, though, in Israel, Yiddish was forbidden from use, as was Ladino, which is the Sephardic version of Yiddish. It's the Spanish Hebrew. And you can't help but think how different the Knesset would be if, instead of the glorious Zionist Hebrew being the only language spoken, if you would hear those living languages of Yiddish and Ladino. And there are movements. And of course, Arabic, which was the language of the place itself. So.
And the Ethiopian Jews speak
They speak Amharic, yes, but there are eight languages right around Addis Ababa, but there's 57 languages in Ethiopia.
You know. How many people here spoke a foreign language at home growing up?
I spoke English.
What did you speak? Swedish? Yes?
Filipino and Spanish.
By Filipino, it's Tagalog, huh?
French
Not
and German.
Not Ilocano or Ibanag. That's what I wanted to hear about. You see, it's like saying you speak Chinese. You know, there's 800 languages in China.
We're going around the table. All right, that's okay. Yes? Who else? Danish?
Icelandic?
Irish. Yeah.
Romanian?
Yiddish Romanian.
Anybody else on this? So this is, yes? French and Yiddish? Greek and Cypriot, Danish. Okay, well, this is to be continued.
Yes, this will be to be continued.
This is to be continued. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Thurman.
I'm not going to read because we're too late. I just want to read one, no, I'm going to read one line from Dinesen at the end of Babette's Feast. See, that which we have chosen is given us, and that which we have refused is also and at the same time granted us. Before we leave, the Danish ambassador and consul to New York, Mr. Carl Friis Madsen, would like to say a word to us.
Thank you very much, and that's because Judith said at the beginning of this meal that it was a tradition for the gentleman sitting next to the hostess to toast. And the Danes around this table will know that's not quite true. It is the tradition of the man sitting next to the hostess to thank the hostess. And usually we thank for the excellent meal that we have received. And in this case, Judith, you have been the perfect Babette 2.0. And what you have served for us tonight is not the kind of food that Babette served, but you have served one incredible offer after the other. And I think that we all felt that we could spend the entire evening with each author, listening to them reading and asking them questions, but obviously we didn't have time for that. And you did a perfect job in getting every one of them on board, so I just want to thank you so much for that. Thank you.
very important thing, those of you who would like to buy a book signed, we have a table here, and the authors will be very happy to autograph them for you. And I wish you a very happy spring, and may the cardinal come and alight on your boughs.